Hey, welcome back to another online service here at Corridor Community Church. I'm Pastor Daryl Drover, and so thankful today you've jumped online and joined us for our service here today. We have some worship from our service this past Sunday. We have the last in our series in the life and the leadership of Joshua planned as well. We'll share that in a little bit. We also plan to do communion today in our service online. So if you have some crackers, juice, water, whatever you have at your home, right where you're watching today, you can prepare in advance to take communion together with us online here at the end of our service. Always such a privilege and a blessing to be able to remember and honor the Lord's sacrifice together. So let's jump into some worship. Let me read for you Psalms 33 as we begin our time together today. It says, "Let the godly sing for joy to the Lord. It's fitting for the pure to praise him. Praise the Lord with melodies on the lyre. Make music for him on the 10-stringed harp and sing a new song of praise to him. Play skillfully on the harp and sing with joy, for the word of the Lord holds true." We can trust everything that he does. He loves whatever is just and good. The unfailing love of the Lord fills the earth. God bless you today as you sing along with us and worship together.
You hear me when I call. You are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Who shall
friend of mine, the God. If God is for us, then who can be against us? Hallelujah. All right, now this old hymn this morning, I think, is a special request. Adam was the one who said we should do it, but now he's not going to sing it. He's going to make me do it. But I think you can all help us out this morning. You know this one well. Victory in Jesus. Are you ready? Here we go.
I heard an old story.
Another month in 2021. February, January is long gone, and so the year goes quickly by, week to week, day by day, and we thank God for His many blessings every day, every week that are new to us. In a moment, of course, we run our ad for Tithely, and we encourage you to take this time to prayerfully consider what it is that God might lay on your heart to give today. Whether you give to your local church, if you're part of a local church in your community, I encourage you to give there. Of course, you can give here to the couple of ways that we'll promote in a moment. You can give to missions, and we've already made known this year our support, our challenge to our people to support in a greater way the work of God that's happening in Cambodia particularly. We're partnering with a great family that's doing an important work there. Let me share from 2 Corinthians 9, a verse that we are pondering ourselves here at Corridor Community Church this year. It says that 2 Corinthians 9:6, a farmer who plants just a few seeds will only get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. And you must decide in your heart how much to give. Don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. The key for me in thinking about this verse this year is that we ought to decide in our hearts, make a faithful and purposeful commitment to God as to what we will give. Sometimes we are guilty of giving under pressure or out of a sense of something that we think we should give to in the moment, but those times maybe God does speak to us and we ought to obey. But if we think ahead for this year and we ask ourselves, what would we like to achieve in our giving this year? How can we be faithful to what God has blessed us with? And we set a goal and we ask God for his help and his guidance in achieving that. Then we give week to week, month to month, faithfully towards that. We decide in our hearts, we purpose in our hearts to set aside what is God's and we give it to him, to honor him and out of obedience. So today, I want to thank you again for your faithful giving. I pray and ask that you would seek God and his will for your giving and your stewardship this year. Plant generously, and I believe based on God's word, we also will reap a generous harvest.
Supporting your local church should be easy and hassle-free, even when you're not at service. No cash, no checkbook, no problem. Meet Tithely, the solution that goes where you go. Using our free smartphone app, you can give to your church whether you're in service, on vacation, sick at home, or any other place in the world. Simply download the app, enter your credit card or checking account information, enter the amount, set where you want to give, and click Give. You'll receive an email confirmation of your gift. You're done and set up for the next donation. With Tithely, you can give recurring gifts or give one time. Wallet free, super fast, secure. Download the app now from the App Store for iOS or Android. Tithely, the simplest way to give to your local church.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. Thank you, Lord. You were condemned. I'm proud of the world.
Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe.
Jump back into our study in Joshua, and as I mentioned earlier, this will be our final sermon today on this life and leadership and ministry of Joshua, as we've been asking God to stir our hearts together as a church and as you've joined us online, that God would raise us up to be the godly leaders that we need in this world, in our communities, in our workplaces, in our families, in our church. And so we've learned a number of important lessons so far. Joshua, the story and life of Joshua has taught us to trust God even against improbable circumstances, to put action to our faith, not just to sit back waiting for God to do all that he needs to do, but we need to step out and trust him and act in faith. We also learned the importance of obeying and studying and being a student of God's word. So important. God's word directs our everyday decisions and our life and growth in faith. We also last week reviewed and saw a tough lesson from the life of Joshua, which is the consequences of sin and the mercy and forgiveness of God. We thank him today, and we'll remember in a few moments together the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross as we take communion together. So Joshua is regarded in history as one of the most, in the history of Israel, one of the most effective and godly leaders. We've already established that. We've reviewed a number of key points in his life. But today we're going to see that even Joshua is susceptible, like all of us are, to deception, to being deceived and led astray. Very important. Proverbs 3, 5 and 6 is a very familiar passage. Let me just share it with you quickly. It says, "Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and don't depend on your own understanding, but seek his will in all that you do, and he will show you which path to take." One of the greatest temptations of leaders or of all of us as people and as believers in Christ is to rely too much on our own wisdom, on our own understanding, rather than seek the guidance and the direction of Almighty God. Doesn't make sense, does it? When we have at our disposal, the all-knowing creator of the universe, his spirit, which lives within us as believers in Christ, and yet we many times choose to follow and be led down another path because we think we know what's best. We think we can discern in our own understanding, and God's word warns us against that. Joshua, let's jump quickly in your Bibles, in your apps, to Joshua chapter 9, and we're going to read together just the first few verses as we jump through the last portion of our study together on the life of Joshua. It says that all the kings west of the Jordan River heard what had happened. The kings of the Hittites, Amorites, Canaanites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites, who lived in the hill country in the western foothills all along the coast of the Mediterranean Sea, as far north as the Lebanon Mountains. These kings combined their armies to fight as one against Joshua and the Israelites. Verse 3, "But when the people of Gibeon heard what Joshua had done to Jericho and Ai, they resorted to deception to save themselves. They sent ambassadors to Joshua, loading their donkeys with weathered saddlebags and old patched wineskins. And they put on worn out patched sandals and ragged clothes. And the bread that they took with them was dry and moldy. All right, pause our reading for a moment. We'll jump down a few verses. But as we're reading today and understanding this important period of history of Israel, Joshua, we see that there's great concern over Israel's advancement into the region, into the promised land that God had set aside for his people. And it seemed unlikely that one single army was going to be able to stand up and push back against Israel, against their advancement. And so all the kings we just read decide to join forces and wage war against Joshua and the Israelites. But there was one group, the Gibeonites, who wanted no part of any such battle, any such resistance. And so they developed this elaborate scheme, this elaborate plan, where they will deceive the Israelites and convince them that they are from a distant land, that they don't actually reside in the promised land, but they're from afar, and they don't want Israel to come and essentially overtake them when the time comes. And so they make all of these deceptions as to how they can convince the Israelites to come into an alliance with the Gibeonites to make peace with them. Let's jump down into verse 14 of Joshua chapter 9. It says, the Israelites examined their food, but they didn't consult the Lord. And then Joshua makes a peace treaty with them, guaranteeing their safety. And the leaders of the community ratified their agreement with a binding oath. Now, why is all of this a big deal? Why is it in Scripture for us, and what's the point of it today? Well, in Deuteronomy 20, if we were to look back, verses 16 to 18, another record of this exact same period in history, God instructs Joshua and the Israelites specifically not to make any type of treaty, any type of oath or alliance with any nation within Canaan, which includes the Gibeonites. And so we learn an important point about godly leadership here, is that you can't always rely on what makes natural sense. So the Israelites examine the food, they listen to this story that they're being told by these strange people, the Gibeonites, and on the surface, it seems to add up. It seems like they are from a far away, and it would make no difference whether or not they enter into a peace treaty with these people. They're not inhabitants of the land that God has instructed them not to make a peace treaty with. Joshua 9, verse 16 says that 3 days after making the treaty, the Israelites learned that these people actually live nearby. So although on the surface all things looked to be in order as far as what the Gibeonites were telling the Israelites, but when they discovered 3 days later that this was actually not true, these were people that lived within the promised land, people that God had told them specifically not to make an alliance with. We can look in our own lives, each one of us, and take a moment of reflection and see that there were times when we thought something was as it seemed, only to discover it really wasn't. And we probably, all of us, can enter into this sense of deception, this betrayal, and how we felt in the moment. We may have felt hurt. Maybe you felt like you wanted to exact revenge, that it was unfair what had happened to you, that someone would deliberately lead you astray. And so we see that the people of Israel in Joshua 9, if we continue to read down, they felt the exact same way. They felt deceived and betrayed by these strange people, the Gibeonites, whom they were exercising good faith in making a treaty with, an alliance. And so now they want to exact revenge. Let's see what happens in Joshua 9, jumping down to verse 19. It says, the people of Israel grumbled against the leaders because of the treaty, but the leaders replied, since we have sworn an oath in the presence of the Lord God of Israel, we cannot touch them. Think about this for a moment. Have you ever broken a promise? Have you ever given your word and not fulfilled what you said? Again, the reality is, in all likelihood, we all have done this. Maybe we didn't do it intentionally. Maybe we didn't do it maliciously like we're reading about today that the Gibeonites had done. Sometimes we break a promise simply because we can't keep it. We extended ourselves and made a promise that was impossible for us to fulfill, even if we wanted to fulfill it. But in the day in which we live, the sad reality is this: many promises simply are unfulfilled or are broken because we aren't ready and faithful to pass through the challenges that arise and come our way. We think about the many marriages and commitments that have fallen apart because of difficulties and challenges, or in our work, when we offer a quote on a job or we enter into a contract with a supplier and we simply can't deliver. We simply face challenges and shortages, and then we just can't keep our promise, can't keep our word. When we make a commitment to volunteer our time for an organization or for church, or as a student, you're committed to your schoolwork, and then you take a part-time job, and then you have other things going on, lessons and sports, and it just seems to be too much to fulfill all your commitments. We make a promise, we make promises, and sadly, we at times are quick to back out of them. Our society tends to disregard the significance of keeping our word. And Scripture warns us about living this kind of life. Jesus himself, if we jump to the New Testament, in the book of Matthew, speaks about this very boldly in Matthew chapter 5. Let me just read a few verses to you where he teaches about it. He says, "You've heard that our ancestors were told not to break vows, or you must carry out the vows that you make to the Lord. But I say, don't make any vows. Don't say by heaven, because heaven is God's throne. Don't say by the earth, because the earth is his footstool. And don't say by Jerusalem, for Jerusalem is the city of the great king. Don't even say by my head, you can't turn one hair white or black, but just simply say, yes, I will, or no, I won't. Anything beyond that is from the evil one." Jesus and God in his word tells us that we ought to be people of our word. We ought to be people that when we say yes, we're going to do something, that we do it. When we say no, that we fulfill that and say and do what we say we're going to do or not do. In Joshua's case, jumping back into the story of Joshua, here's the situation he finds himself in. They've made an oath in the name of the Lord that binds them to a foolish treaty with ungodly people. And by doing so, they're actually violating instructions that God has specifically given them. It's not an easy situation to find themselves in. In fact, it's a very challenging one. And as leaders, these are the times when we are, again, put to the test, when our character and our morality and our convictions are stretched to the limit. What does Joshua legitimately do in this situation? Well, let's jump back into Joshua 9 and read it through again for ourselves. It says in verse 20, Joshua gives these instructions. "This is what we must do. We must let them live, for divine anger would come upon us if we broke our oath. Let them live." So they made them woodcutters and water carriers for the entire community, as the Israelite leaders directed. So amazingly enough, we see in Scripture that Joshua decides and the Israelites decide to keep their oath and word that they made to the Gibeonites, even though they were deceived, even though these were not godly people, but they gave their word and they honored it. It's amazing. All of us today, if we take God's word to heart, can learn an important lesson as leaders and as godly people, that when we give our word, we have to do anything and everything to stand by it. if we were to continue reading, and I encourage you in your own time to take some more time to explore the rest of Joshua, how the history unfolds. But in Joshua 10, very shortly after our reading here in chapter 9, we see that the Amorite kings, the forces of the rest of the kings that were about to attack Israel, turn their sights and choose to attack the Gibeonites because of this alliance that they've now made. And so the Gibeonites call out to Israel and to Joshua for help. And so Joshua, again, because of the treaty and the peace that he has made with the Gibeonites, is not just enough not to attack them, but he has to come and help them and come to their defense. And that's exactly what they do. With God's help, they are able to defend the Gibeonites and defeat the rest of the armies. It's amazing. Actually, in Joshua 10, verses 12 and 13, again, a very famous episode in the life of Joshua when he prays and asks God to keep the sun still so that they can continue to battle and win the war that they're involved with. And amazingly, Scripture tells us that God holds the sun in place. The sun stays in place for a full day as the battle continues. A reminder again to all of us that there is no limit to what God can do. He is all-powerful, all-knowing, almighty. The problem is, the reminder today is, that we are not. Joshua was not. He was a human being just like you and I. He was a great leader. He was a great man of God. Yes, all of that is true. But he found himself in a difficult situation with the Gibeonites, as we read today, because he was careless. He was easily deceived and led astray because he didn't consult God, the Scripture told us earlier. You know, we have an enemy as well that the Bible warns us about that wants to deceive us. 2 Corinthians 11:14 says that Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. It was his deception that led to the original sin in the Garden of Eden. And in fact, we jumped ahead to Matthew 5 a little earlier, but Matthew 4, the chapter before, is a famous reading where Satan actually tempts Jesus, the Son of God, with God's word, with twisting Scripture, telling him, if you just throw yourself down from this height, that God's angels will bear you up. That's how Satan operates. He makes a part truth sound like it's real, but we have to be discerning and we have to be in tune with the Spirit of God to stand against the tricks and the deceptions of the enemy. As godly leaders, we have to be vigilant and aware that deception is coming at our door on a constant basis, wanting to lead us from God's plan and from God's very best. Now, if we're going to end today, as I said, in the life of Joshua, but I want to just jump right back to the very last chapter in the book, Joshua 24. And this, of course, is, again, a very famous verse that we often quote from Joshua from his life. Here he is in his final days, reflecting upon God's great faithfulness. And these words that we're about to read together will serve as a challenge to the people and to us to reaffirm our commitment to serve God. Let's read Joshua 24, verse 14 and 15. He says, "Fear the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols your ancestors worshipped when they lived beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt, and serve the Lord alone. If you refuse to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve." The choice is yours and mine to make. But Joshua says, "Would you prefer the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates, or will it be the gods of the Amorites in whose land we now live? As for me and my family, we will serve the Lord." Joshua remained faithful to the end. And that, again, is a principle of godly leadership. Leaders finish what they start. Despite some missteps along the way, which we read today Joshua made, and he probably made others besides that are not even recorded here, but he made some missteps. He was easily deceived. He, at times, had his faith challenged, and when he was defeated at Ai, we saw how he had to follow up his failure and trust God once again. All of the same things you and I are likely to face in our lifetime. But Joshua remained faithful. He remained strong and courageous. Don't be discouraged with the challenges of today, with the obstacles that you may face this week, with the uncertainty of tomorrow. Trust God, be strong and courageous, and stay faithful till the end. Service together today, and just as we had done this morning when we met in person, we would have had communion, taken a few moments together to take communion together. It's an important tradition that we hold to, and we thank God for the opportunity to reflect and remember upon His great sacrifice. And it's not something we ought to do lightly or flippantly, but reverently and solemnly, as we think about what Jesus did for us, dying on the cross, shedding His precious blood, so that our sins could be forgiven, so that we could be made new, that we can ask for forgiveness for all the times that we allow sin in our hearts and we disobey God and fall short of His best. God is merciful and faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. 1 John 1:9, which we looked at last Sunday. So today, if you have a chance yet to go get your crackers or water, juice, so that you can follow along with us, I have our emblems here that we use as well. And as we look at God's word, I hope you will reflect for these few moments together and thank God of the blessing it is to be restored in right relationship with Him. Matthew 26 records for us that Jesus, as he was eating with his disciples, took bread and he blessed it, and he broke it in pieces and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take this and eat it, for this is my body." Let's take our bread, our cracker, wafer together, and remember the broken body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And then it says that he took a cup of wine and he gave thanks to God for it. And he gave it to each of them and said, "Drink from it. This is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people, poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Mark my words, I will not drink wine again until the day that I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." So let's take our juice, water, whatever you have, and think about the precious blood that Jesus shed for you and I. Father, we close this service today thinking of your Son, Jesus, who died on the cross, who gave his life willingly. The scripture says, "He who knew no sin became sin, taking on the sin of the world," as we read today, that many would be forgiven. I thank you for those watching today, those who have joined in this service. I pray that they would sense anew the importance of this great sacrifice, of having that relationship restored with you, that forgiveness is available to each one, whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord, can be saved, can be made new. We thank you today for the freedom we have to live in relationship with you, to follow after you. Help us, as we learn today, not to be tempted to be led astray and deceived, but to be holy and righteous in all of our ways, to live a life that is pleasing and honorable to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I hope you have a great week this week, and thanks again for joining us. It's such a blessing to be able to minister online and still meet in person. If you're in our area, we again would encourage you to join us in person on Sunday mornings at 10:30. We have an exciting time of worship together and learning from God's word, as well as just having some fellowship at a distance with each other. And so it's so encouraging to meet together in person. It's also a great blessing to be online together. So we thank you again for joining us. May God richly bless you, and that you would have a wonderful, prosperous, and effective week serving Him.